Hello, and welcome to PBS NewsHour's conversation with Wall Street Journal senior sports reporter Rachel Bachman. Today, we're tackling the Winter Olympics. Rachel, thank you so much for joining me.
So glad to be here, Nicole.
This is the 24th Winter Olympic Games. This time around, it's in Beijing, and we're just over 2 years into a global pandemic that's killed millions of people around the world. Can you explain the zero COVID approach China is taking and how that affects everyone involved in the games?
Well, essentially what China has done since the original outbreak in Wuhan in 2019 is to not accept basically any outbreaks of COVID in the country. And so anytime there are even a handful of cases, there are really extreme measures taken by the authorities there, from widespread testing to lockdowns of entire cities with 10 million people or more. What this means for the Olympics is that the entire games will operate inside what they call a closed loop. So when people like myself and all the athletes at the Olympics and so on arrived inside that loop, we had to test in and we can't go anywhere else, just the Olympic venues, transport, and our hotels. And that's really it. And that is exactly designed to keep the world separated from the Chinese public.
How are you navigating that? And can you explain to me the process of being inside of the closed loop so that you can be a part of the games and what that means for athletes as well?
Well, for everyone involved in these Olympics, it's been an incredibly stressful lead up to the games because, of course, a couple of months ago, we experienced the start of the Omicron wave. And a number of Olympic athletes even have fairly recent COVID cases, which you can imagine is very stressful when you're talking about traveling internationally to the Olympics in a place that doesn't tolerate COVID cases. So some cases knocked athletes out of the games entirely. And in other cases, athletes had to take repeated tests to illustrate that they were COVID-free and show that evidence to Chinese organizers in order to be allowed in the country. And so luckily, the vast majority of athletes who hope to be at these Olympics are going to arrive safely or have arrived safely at the Olympics. But that stress is ongoing.
There's also this distinction of getting into the loop and then what happens if you test positive. How are organizers navigating that? And does that potentially exclude you from participating in the games?
In a word, yes, it does. So if an athlete, for instance, were to pass all the hurdles, pass the tests, get into the closed loop and start to train and so on, but then one day on a test, bam, they get a positive, that athlete will immediately be isolated and will not be able to come out of isolation until symptoms are gone and the athlete has two consecutive negative tests. And so this might mean that some athletes test positive and are simply wiped out of the Olympics and have to spend the rest of their time in Beijing in isolation.
China is also under increased scrutiny because of the treatment of Uyghur Muslims in the country. How is that playing out on the international stage, and how is the world reacting to that within the context of these games?
Well, of course, the U.S. led what they're calling a diplomatic boycott of these Olympics over those very allegations of human rights violations in China. And several other prominent nations followed, the U.K., Canada, Australia. But generally speaking, all the athletes from those countries are still going to the games. What it has meant practically for those athletes is that many of them have been asked about those allegations of human rights violations. Most of them have declined to comment on them because, of course, the Chinese government has denied these allegations. They say they don't violate human rights. And so the athletes are in a very difficult situation. They're at risk of offending their hosts on a topic that they're very sensitive about. And so the vast majority of athletes have chosen not to comment on this topic. And some of them have even told us that they fear that doing so would threaten their personal safety.
Has China addressed how it will handle protests if any happen?
China has said that it would consider some kind of punishment for athletes who speak out politically, for instance, give a gesture on the medal stand or on the field of play. By the way, that is already against the rules under the International Olympic Committee. Athletes are not supposed to protest or make sort of political symbols on the medal stand or on the field of play. They can voice their opinions in interviews and so on, but there is a little bit of overlap between the IOC rules and what Beijing might or might not tolerate at the Olympics. But we really won't know until perhaps someone voices an opinion or, for instance, criticizes the government, and then we will find out.
There's also government surveillance concerns in addition to the human rights controversies. And government surveillance has been an ongoing issue in China for decades. How are people that are coming into China for these games, be it athletes, staffers, reporters, navigating that?
Well, Team USA, for instance, has recommended to its athletes to not bring their cell phones. So they've recommended using disposable or burner phones if athletes are going to bring phones to the games, and I imagine most of them will. Most can't live without them. So that's quite a dramatic change from past Olympics. I've never been to an Olympics where Olympic governing bodies recommended against using personal technology in the host country. And many media organizations, such as myself, are taking similar precautions and are advising people to take disposable tech devices or to wipe them before they go to China and then wipe them when they come back, just as a precaution.
How are you navigating the surveillance issues?
Well, it's a very interesting situation when, such as in the case with our newspaper, The Wall Street Journal, occasionally state-backed media in China will actually call out our newspaper by name for a critical story or report. I can tell you that's not typical for someone like myself, who's a sports writer and has covered many Olympic games and other big events. Generally speaking, that just doesn't happen. People who organize these big events are used to a certain level of criticism. So it is a very, very unusual games in that respect.
Once you do get there and get into the closed loop and get into the groove of reporting, what are you most excited to see in terms of the events, and who are some of the athletes we should be keeping an eye on?
Well, there are a lot of great stories, and the nice thing about the Olympics is, even as controversial as these particular games are, at a certain point, they really are about the athletes. And, you know, every day at the Olympics, every hour at the Olympics is the most important hour in someone's life. And that's a pretty compelling thing to experience on an everyday basis. American alpine skier Michaela Schifrin is once again attempting 5 events, which is a huge slate, and has a good chance to medal in a couple of them. Shaun White is coming back for his 5th Olympics and trying to defend his crown as really the king of snowboarding. Chloe Kim, another gold medalist snowboarder from the last games, is back. She's also American. And then I would say probably the most intriguing personality at this games is a woman named Eileen Gu, who is U.S. born. She grew up in San Francisco, still lives there with her mom and grandmother. She's Chinese American. A few years ago, she announced she would compete for China at these games. So she's only 18 years old, and she's already a sensation in China. She's a fantastic freestyle skier. She'll enter 3 events and has a pretty good chance to medal in 2 or 3 of them, including freestyle half pipe, freestyle slope style, and an event called Big Air, which is basically jumping off a giant jump and being judged on the tricks that you do off of it. And it's really a fascinating situation where she's been embraced by a country that really does not have a very long winter sports history, but very badly wants to win more medals than it ever has at a Winter Games, and is very proud to have her on board with both Chinese ancestry and someone who could have competed for the U.S. but chose China.
In many ways, Eileen Gu also represents this sort of friendly patriotism and friendly competitive patriotism that's always existed with the Olympic Games. Can you explain some of the nuances of what that means for her and for the countries that she represents, both China in the Olympics and where she lives in the United States?
Well, she said that the reason she wants to compete for China is so she's able to inspire all the kids in that country, especially girls, in a way that maybe she couldn't in other countries. You know, one of the big initiatives in China is to get more than 300 million Chinese into snow sports, which is, if you think about it, is just a Herculean goal. And they say they've reached that, by the way. So she really has said that she wants to inspire the Chinese public and Chinese girls in particular. Competing for China, in addition, there's no question that it's opened her up to a gigantic market. And she does have several very prominent sponsors, Bank of China, China Mobile, and others, along with international sponsors, Louis Vuitton, Tiffany, Red Bull, and on and on. So she really is straddling the two biggest economies in the world and reaping the benefits of really both of them right now. And she's won many competitions. She's an outstanding freestyle skier. She's never won an Olympic medal. So it's really remarkable for someone in her sport to have so much sponsor backing, but have never won an Olympic medal, never even competed in an Olympics. I think the most interesting thing about her is the unanswered questions about her citizenship status. So typically, the IOC requires athletes to be a citizen of the country for which they're going to compete. And China does not, as a policy, allow dual citizenship. But we were not able to confirm in our reporting that Eileen Gu turned in her U.S. passport or renounced her citizenship. And so it's really not clear right now what her status is.
We'll definitely be keeping an eye out for Eileen Gu and her events and all of the other athletes that you named. And for your reporting. Thank you so much for joining us, Rachel.
Thank you.